and thrice he had demanded the order to be repeated, ere, with tears in his eyes, he had turned his back on his countrymen and countrywomen and steamed to sea.
"Of all asinine things to leave us in the lurch this way!"
Habert was denouncing the powers to be of his country.
"Mayo would never have done it. Mark my words, he had to take program from Washington, and here we are and our dear ones scattered for 50 miles back up country. Say, if I lose Billy Boy, I'll never dare go home to face the wife. Come on, let the three of us make a start. We can throw the fear of God into any gang on the streets."
"Come on over and take a squint,"
Davis invited from where he stood somewhat back from the window, looking down into the street. It was gorged with rioters, all haranguing, cursing, crying out death, and urging one another to smash the doors, but each hanging back from the death he knew waited behind those doors for the first of the rush.
"We can't break through a bunch like that, Habert," was Davies' comment.
"And if we die under their feet, we'll be of little use to Billy Boy or anybody else up the Panuco,"
Wemple added.
"And if..."
A new movement of the mob caused him to break off. It was splitting before a slow and silent advance of a file of white-clad men.
"Blue jackets! Mayo's come back for us after all,"
Habert muttered.
"Then we can get a navy launch," Davies said.
The bedlam of the mob died away, and in silence the sailors reached the street door and knocked for admittance. All three went down to open it, and to discover that the callers were not Americans, but two German lieutenants and half a dozen German marines. At sight of the Americans, the rage of the mob rose again and was quelled by the grounding of the rifle butts of the marines.
"No, thank you,"
the senior lieutenant, in passable English, declined the invitation to enter. He unconcernedly kept his cigar alive at such times that the mob drowned his voice.